Okay, so you say to do it for 30 minutes in vinegar then, is that right?
But yeah. if you have 10 minutes, that's okay. It's the whole thing about eco-printing is there's nothing that's ever set in stone. And I just did a bunch of paper prints today and half of them came out great and half of them didn't, doing the exact same way. You know, it's crazy. And mostly everything comes up fine. It's just not, you can't make it the way you want it, which in a way I find delicious because, you know, we all get really good at what we do and suddenly we can't make this happen the way we want. It's kind of relaxing that way, I find, so.
I'm all for relaxing.
That's a very positive attitude for mistakes.
Yes, well, and you can't, there is no way you can control this, so I really like that. So I'm going to show you first a few samples. Does everybody pretty much know what eco-printing is, or anybody just had no, okay, Beth doesn't, okay. I know a lot of you have seen my scarves up at the sale, so I'm going to show you these a few samples, and it's going to show you what we can do. These are done on this is kind of an expensive silk called silk charmeuse. So, all right, so let's spotlight that. Yeah, so we're still working out a little closer here. Okay, so it's a shiny silk. All silks and wools are animal fibers. They tend to take eco-printing the best of all. You can also do cotton. I guess I don't have a satin sample that. It tends to be more brown and white. It does not quite as colorful, but it's just as beautiful. So on this one, maybe I'll put this light over here. Sorry, I'm still trying to arrange this. I got some good greens. The reds right here are always from eucalyptus, which we are really lucky to have because all my teachers, like in Ireland, they can't get eucalyptus. You can't transfer it in. It's really hard to get. And we have it invasive like crazy in California. So this is some rose. Usually you don't get the same color that you think you're going to get. So you use a purple flower, you don't always get purple. The green rose does, however, print green. Eucalyptus, of course, is sage green and prints red. This is a maple leaf right here. You see that. And it generally, any of the leaves that have tannin in them, which would be pecans and sumac and walnuts, all the nuts trees tend to print on the blackish side.
How about the berries, like the sumac berries and the berries?
They usually don't print. It's really interesting. Okay. You know, and I will say, I've come across things, I'll say they don't print, and then somebody later will get them printed. So, but I haven't found them to print.
I recently cut down or trimmed a bunch of ajurita, and the wood is very yellow. Does it?
Yes. And I have not tried to print agarita. That would be a fun thing to experiment with.
Agarita, okay.
You have to make sure you don't use the leaves because they'll poke holes in your silk. You'd have to, you could trim.
Yes, I know what the leaves do.
Yeah.
Okay, so would you like shave the wood or?
You can't really roll the wood up tight, so I would probably throw it in the bath water, throw it in the water that you steam in. And so we're doing steaming, and I'll tell you why in a little bit instead of boiling or simmering. If you use simmering, you can throw all kinds of things and throw your whole scarf in there. It's a bit process, and it's very smelly and strong and usually needs to be done outdoors with special pots. So this is a lighter one. You can still see the peaches from the eucalyptus and the eucalyptus stems. And there's some more, I think that's walnut. See what's on the back. Some more eucalyptus. So this one was done lighter. I'll show you how. We'll talk about doing light versus dark. This is a scarf you guys have, not silk charmeuse, but silk. It's a different kind. It's a little more affordable and it's a little airier. And so this is what I like to teach on. This scarf got really dark because I had a lot of, obviously a lot of tannins in the water. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that. Okay, so that's where we're starting. Before I forget, oh wait, which is a silk.
Oh, cute.
Oh, how pretty.
Yeah, and it came out really well. Now this one, I didn't want any shadowing at all. I didn't want the browns and grays, which are really kind of the magic part of eco-printing. So, and I did this with straight vinegar and no rust water. So that's something we'll talk about. Okay. So in the beginning, you have your vinegar, which we talked about, and I have made rust water for you. So rust water, all that is, well, it's pretty complicated, actually, I should say. It starts out where you just take rusty objects and you soak them in vinegar. I have a big bucket outside. I just leave it forever and ever. I throw more rusty objects in. Vinegar is really acetic, and it'll help dissolve the rust. So you're getting a lot of iron in the water. At the same time, every time I use the water in the boiling system, I will throw in bark and the leftover of the bur oak shells. And I end up with this kind of primordial soup, and I will use that as my rust water. But for the starting off, you just straight vinegar and rusty nails or rusty wire, whatever. Usually takes a good month to get it going. So that's something you can just keep on hand and put it in plastic. Don't put it in a metal bucket, it'll eat right through. Don't ask me how I know that.
How about glass container?
Glass is perfect, yeah. Glass is great, yeah.
Rust water is really rusty objects and vinegar. It's not really water. There's no water in it.
You're exactly right. The terminology, yeah, it's a popular terminology. It's not quite exactly right, yeah.
Okay.
You can also, like over the winter, sometimes I get these weird growths on it, and you just stir them in. I mean, you keep this as gross as you possibly can, and it works better that way. So first we're gonna look at, here's the difference. When we're steaming, you don't have quite as much of the chemistry going on that will darken and make plants more intense. But it also, I can do it in my house. It doesn't smell at my house very much. I smell it. My husband doesn't smell very well, so it's fine. If you really get into big batches or you want to get some really, really intense stuff going on, then I recommend doing it outside. I have a gas, the kind of aluminum pot with, a crawfish crab cooker kind of thing set up. And that's what I do usually. But I do like the steaming. And there's one woman who even has learned to figure out a way to steam in the microwave in a plastic bag. And her website is called Made by Barb, which I can always remember that. And I have not done that yet, but it might be a good way to do it. So we're gonna talk about next your pots. This is probably one of the most important things to talk about in your pot. Yeah, good. This pot is stainless steel. The more traditional pot that causes more reactivity is an aluminum pot. And mine's on the stove right now, but your parents and grandparents probably had these aluminum round cookers. They were really, really common. And then they all went out of favor when somebody decided aluminum was not good to have in your food, which it does get in your food. It's very gray whether it's toxic or not. So most people gave away their aluminum cooker. So I have a fish pot. Let's see if I can bring it in here. One second. It's called a fish kettle. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I got this one at Goodwill. They're pretty easy to find. Getting harder. And then I have a really solid one, and I bought at a restaurant a really thick, beautiful, giant aluminum pot. And the way you know whether it's aluminum or metal is try a magnet on it. Magnet sticks. It's not aluminum. Aluminum and magnet won't stick to it. So if you really get into this, aluminum pots are going to work better, but most people don't have them anymore. So what I would recommend, just use your stainless steel pot.
Barbara, there's what I found is a tamale cooker that I've had for years. I would do it. It's humongous, but I'm pretty sure it's so thin it's probably aluminum too. So you can look for tamaleria.
Perfect. Now, the one thing, when you do use an aluminum pot, you can't use it for food anymore.
Right.
Because there's too much reactivity going on. Stainless steel, I've used it. They clean out really well. I don't even smell the vinegar anymore, so I just don't worry about it. Some people are really purists and say you should never mix your kitchenware, you know, with this process, but I use all my kitchenware for art, so I'm a little bit loose on that one. You also are going to need something inside to raise when you put your bundle in. It'll be wrapped around a stick and it needs to be raised out of the water. This is actually even a little bit too low here, so I'll put a jar maybe down there. It all depends on how you can manage to make your size stick fit in your pot. So obviously the bigger, the better works. Better for them. All right.
So is it okay if we use like the old canning cans?
What about what?
Is it like this is a canning pan.
All right, let me see where you are. Let me get back to gallery view 1 second.
Is that gonna hurt that pan?
Okay, where are you? Raise your hand.
Right here.
Oh yeah. The canning pan. Those are porcelain covered. And I don't have any idea, but I would suspect I probably wouldn't cook in it again, but I don't know that for a fact.
Oh.
Maybe you could line it with foil or something. I don't know.
Yeah, I borrowed it from Beatrice.
So I've got a question. I have another pan. It's that it's probably, you know, I've used it to, you know, your water bath, you put the jars into it so food doesn't go into those pans. But is black with little spots on it. I think that's enamel also, you know, they're popular. So those are not the
those
best.
Are not- I've seen them that not recommended, but I think the reason they're not recommended is because you really want an aluminum pot to cause some more reactivity. It actually makes the aluminum go into the steam and the water. Porcelain, I don't know. And if you don't care about it, you try once and let us know. You can, you know, if you clean it out, you can, in the aluminum, you can still smell the vinegar in there, but in the stainless steel, you can't. So yeah, that's a good question.
Okay.
All right, so what we're going to do now is look at, everybody pull out your bag of leaves. And this is actually sort of the most, obviously, I mean, oddly, the most important information you can have, because every area has different leaves and you can go down the rabbit hole on the internet and look and see what leaves work best in your area. And without fail, it'll be things you have no idea what they are. So over the last 5 years, I have actually come to figure out what leaves work great here. There are some universal ones like oak leaves tend to work. Maple leaves tend to work. Eucalyptus always works. It doesn't matter whether they're dried. I gave you guys some windfall leaves. We have one oak tree that's the same species as at Lost Maples. It's a little baby, so I can't take very many leaves from it. And these fell. Windfall prints beautifully. Your whole batch of leaves has been frozen. You can freeze them, you can unfreeze them, refreeze them. They will all act differently in what season they come from, but as far as I know, no one's ever figured out the exact science, whether you should use spring or fall or whatever. In here, there are rose leaves. We have an antique rose. It's a green rose that before they were made into red, but florist rose leaves work very well. Just be careful that they're not pesticided. Make sure you get organic because you're going to be making steam out of whatever's there. This is a green rose right here, which each of you have one. Here we go. Which prints in the most wonderful way. everybody has some eucalyptus. So what's interesting about the eucalyptus, there's 260 species at least, maybe more. And Trader Joe's carries three different times at different times of the year. Well, actually, it's pretty random. I never know what they're going to have. The leaves on the eucalyptus that are skinny and narrow can print as well as the fat round leaves. Oh, let me get those. One second. Well, I can't find it. There's a silver dollar one that actually attaches to the stem really tightly. And it is very hard to print in that it doesn't lay flat. So if you want to print it, it makes stunningly beautiful prints, but I get it fresh and print it within a few days. So it's still soft. I've even tried taking the dried stuff and soaking it, and it just never quite gets soft enough. So the round leaves are better for the leaf print, and the berries on the skinny guys are better for the berry print. You can never have too many berries. This is flame leaf sumac, which you can see all over our area. It falls early, so I have to catch it like 2 months ago before it all falls off the tree. It turns bright red sometimes and freeze it. This one always prints too. And then most oak leaves, this is just a live oak, print pretty, and I'm sorry, this is a white oak, Spanish oak, white oak. These print pretty well. And I think that's all you've got in your pile. Now, almost every time I do a scarf, I add something else into it to see if it works. And that's always really fun. And most of the time it doesn't, but... there's one of the big round eucalyptus. I knew I put that over here. It's just big fat round guy. All silver dollar.
Barbara, all right. I have a question.
Yeah. Yes.
I was looking up leaves with a lot of tannin.
Yes.
And they said a mesquite was a local leaf that had a lot of tannin. Have you tried mesquite leaf?
That's a great idea. And I just never thought of it being a high tannin plant.
Well, I tried to get some and they've all fallen off the branches by now.
So all right, yeah.
Available, but.
Yeah.
What about blackberry?
Huh?
What about blackberry? They have pretty leaves.
Blackberries, you know, I don't have blackberries. They're known for universally. It's one of those plants that everybody says makes great prints. The okay. leaves, not the berries, but the leaves.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Nandina?
Which one?
Nandina.
I haven't tried Nandina. It's an invasive plant, so I hate Nandina.
It's very invasive. The birds bring it.
It might be a good use for it to boil it. That might be good.
It's a pretty red.
Yeah, that's true. But it's not going to print the way, it's not going to, that red's not going to print. It's interesting. It's probably going to come out green or brown.
Oh, I won't bother then.
Yeah, or you know, try it, let me know. You can prove me wrong. The other thing that I've tried is I have a bougainvillea plant. It's the only non-native plant I have. And it printed actually pretty well. Kind of a lime green leaf. So not the flower, but the leaf. So
can you tell what, these ones you've said that print well, do we know what color they're going to print? Like the blackberry leaves or the white oak? Do they print different colors, each of them?
The only thing I can predict that will print with a color is the rose leaves, and that's green, and the eucalyptus, which prints pink. Everything else is really depend on the chemistry and the temperature and the time you cook it.
How about okay. the onion skin that you have?
Oh, I'm sorry, yes, onion skins, perfect. Onion skins do pretty well, but they don't always turn out purple. I've seen them be black. I'll show you, let's see. This is some paper that we're going to do next week. I'll show you this now because I have to remind you of something or something I didn't put in the thing. This is the same. This is sumac with dipped in rust water. This is sumac, not dipped in rust water and cooked in a stainless steel pot. This is sumac in a stainless steel pot on watercolor paper. This is sumac that I cooked in the aluminum pot, but I don't think I cooked it long enough. Same exact plant. So it goes to show you how it's all dependent on the chemistry and the time and the season you get the leaves and things like that. So sometimes you get some really nice surprises. This was one that, this is one of the paper ones I did like a lot. But it was in the same pot as some of the others in the same time. So I, you know, I don't know. I've been doing it for years and I still can't pin it down. Okay, so what we're gonna do first is we're gonna lay out your scarf in just a minute. And what we do, let me get this other one back out. Not this lighter run out, this is bigger than what you have, but so you can see what we did. So you'll turn your scarf, don't do this yet, let me show you and then we'll do it together. You'll turn your scarf face up and you can tell by the hem if you can't really tell the different surface. And then, let's see, what's a good end? Let's look at this end. What you'll do is we're gonna be laying out the material on one side only. So everything, when we fold this over, will get repeated on the other side. That's one of the main tricks that you need to know. It also means don't put too much stuff on, because it not only repeats, let's see, we can look at, this one's not quite so good. Not only will it repeat on the other side, but we're gonna roll it up and it will repeat again going the long ways. So you'll get way more out of one leaf than you anticipate. Does everybody get that?
Yes.
Okay. I can show you. I'm trying to find one that has a lot of repeat on it. That's really easy to see. Well, now I'm not having any examples. Let's see. That leaf. Yeah, no, never mind. It's not showing as much, but it will repeat other ways too. All right, so get your scarf out and we'll lay it out.
Not wet, as dry as we can get it.
Yeah, it'll be wet, yeah. And I haven't found vinegar to hurt stone or even, I use my wood dining table, it's actually painted and it hasn't really ever hurt it. So I don't think it reacts much more to metals than stone or wood or anything else. So if you don't have, I put plastic down, but if you don't have it, I don't always do that.
So when you say face up, do you mean the hem is turned up towards you or the hem is turned to the bottom?
It'll turn underneath, yeah.
The hem is turned to the bottom, okay.
These scarves that you have are all hand rolled. You can buy them, there's a place called Dharma Trading, which I buy all my stuff, yeah. I really like them. Strong vinegar. And you can buy machine rolled, but they're just a little more elegant to have them hand sewed. It's just a little detail. Now, if you don't have space to spread out your whole scarf, just spread out half, it's fine. We'll work with that. All right, so let me get, there you go. All right, so get it flat as you can. If you do end up rolling wrinkles into it, it just makes for another interesting pattern. So, all right, and then we'll take our leaves. Now there's some leaves will print better vein side down and some vein side face up. In general, the veins print stronger, but the face sometimes will make a more solid area. So it doesn't really matter because you'll be putting it down like this. Let me get my light stronger here. I was telling Gloria, I didn't plan on dark happening. I have a giant wall of windows and I forgot it's gonna get dark. So can you see that? Mm-hmm. Right now I'm placing, I'll come down here. I'm placing my leaves somewhat randomly. I don't know why they're on. When you get to thick ones, if you have full branch, pull them apart because rolling the stems is just too hard. You're going to roll this around the dowel really tightly. So take your stems, just use the lightest, little lightest pieces of stems, not the big thick stuff. I do save that and put that in my water. And then you're going to do a basically a pattern all the way down. So go ahead and start on that. Sometimes because the way you wear scarves, I put more activity toward either end because that's the part people see the most. If you do this beautiful design at the back, nobody ever sees it. So, and I have a little trick that, that I like to do where about where the fold is. Let me come down here with this light. You can also make it go off the thing too, it's fine. But where the fold is, if I fold this over, you'll get a nice little pattern on the other side where they meet in the middle. And it will look like. Okay, well, not that one. This right here, these are just two leaves on one side and I crossed all their stems and then put a leaf in the middle. And that was kind of nice.
Well, what do you do if you don't have enough room? It's too long for the table. You said, don't worry.
Just do half of it and then fold that up. I'll show you. So like if I don't have room right now for the table, I'll just do half of it, fold it up gently and pull it away. There's a lot of times you don't have, especially really long pieces. So I gave you too much stuff to put on one scarf and it doesn't seem like a lot, but you need to save about half of it for your card printing next week. So that kind of tells you how much to use. It's not a whole lot. Although you can get your own, you can get some more materials if you want next week.
So Barbara, I have some bur oak and my maple leaves and you leave the stem. I'm seeing that you have your stems on those, the lighter stems.
Yeah, as long as they can roll and are a little bit flexible, it's fine.
Okay, and so it would be good to have the stems facing in or out?
It totally doesn't matter.
Okay.
Totally didn't matter.
Well, Barbara, the leaves can only be used once. They're not, you can't take them. Yeah.
They give up all their chemistry after that.
All right.
I do keep the eucalyptus a lot of times because it's such a good color and I'll throw that in the big rust pot too, the primordial soup pot. And truthfully, I have a pot that only has vinegar and water in it and another pot that has all the other stuff in it. So I've got a rust water and then I've got the primordial soup and I will mix them when I'm especially doing the boiling stuff. I'll mix them in different proportions. And, but
you another quick question. Vinegar, huh? Would you put the face of the leaf down or up?
It doesn't matter. And you'll experiment kind of whether that plant prints better one way or the other, but they're going to print on both sides because we're
folding. Well, it doesn't matter.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, if you really start to think ahead, you might want to balance out the stronger side of the prints all the way down, stronger, weaker, so it's not all weak on one side. But that's kind of overthinking it. It's not that much fun to think that much about this. All right, so I'm going to pretend I don't have enough room. And also, you can take these berries apart and just scatter them. You can also take, you've got some onion skin, right?
Mm-hmm.
Crumble some onion skin and make some nice little dots of purple usually. And you can also do black tea, make some wonderful little polka dot things. So I'm gonna go ahead right now and fold this over. and kind of straighten it out. And then I'm going to move to the other end. So I'm going to act like I don't really have enough room. Just gently scooch this down.
So I made the mistake of laying out my scarf earlier today, and all my leaves curled up and dried.
Oh, did they?
So can I reconstitute them by putting them back in a plastic bag and putting a little water with them? And
you can do water. You can even do better is even vinegar. Some people actually use water on the scarves and soak the leaf material in vinegar.
Okay.
It's you just want about half vinegar, half water in the whole process. Okay. So yeah, I would just suck them in. Probably maybe some water and vinegar both.
Okay.
Oh, and my rose, my green rose. Let's see.
Are we supposed to be dipping these in the rust water first?
Oh, I said that, didn't I? Yes, I'm so sorry, guys. I forgot that. Thank you for telling me. This is different the way I usually do it, and I forgot that piece. So, dip them in the rust water, and that's going to help bring out all the tannins. And they don't need to be very wet. Surprising how strong it is. I'll go back and do mine too. I should read my own instructions. And we've been growing some lavender, so I'm going to throw a piece of lavender in there for fun. See how that is.
What color will the lavender come out?
I've never tried it. I've never seen it recommended either, so I suspect it's not going to work. All right, so now I'm going back to get my other end so I can dip the leaves in. Some people will tell you to soak the leaves for 30 minutes in rust water, some in vinegar. It's just, there's so many different ways to do this. Also, if you touch the rust water a lot, it does kind of irritate your hands. So I just try and use the stems, or you can use gloves, which is probably recommended. I never do that. I can't feel things very well. If you were to boil these, you'd be boiling in the rust water, so you wouldn't need to dip your leaves. Steam is just a lot weaker of a, it's called a mordant. Mordant is the chemistry, something that enables the chemistry between two items to react. You can also, traditionally they use alum.
Released.
But it's kind of looked down on in Ecoprinting because the whole idea is to use just natural products, although they can be very strong. And alum is also a little bit strong to deal with. It's an aluminum hydrosulfate or something. It's pretty intense, but that will always work. All right, everybody.
Barbara, can I ask about that? Because
yes.
I have done a fair amount of natural dyeing, and so I've used alum, and the thinking at least always used to be that iron saddens your colors.
It does what?
Saddens them. That makes them
darkens them.
Darkens them. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, do you think you might get brighter colors with alum?
You know, I think that's probably true, and I don't really know because I have bought some, but I've never tried working with it. I've had so much fun doing this one that I haven't. Of a tablespoon of powder in the bath, so yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, your scarves are so beautiful. I've never seen any. I mean, I've I have quite a few friends who've done eco printing, but none of them come out as well as yours do. So that's why I'm watching tonight.
You know, I learned, the woman who taught me felting in Ireland had already, a lot of felters transitioned into eco printing because it's so much less work. And mm-hmm. they were kind of way ahead along, you know, a few years before everybody else. So that's, I'm using mostly her technique with a few of my own in there. But yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you look on the internet, there are so many different ways to do it, and a lot of them just end up more brown than it should look at.
Barbara?
All right, so now.
Barbara?
Yes.
I've noticed that when I dip something in the rust water, and then it maybe a drip of it gets on the scarf, and it makes it, okay, because it's going to make it a little bit of orangey or something, right?
Yeah, it's just going to add some to it, yeah.
Good.
All right, so now make sure you line up your seams as best you can along the long side. And what we're gonna do now is take something heavy, and I happen to have this. You can use a base, anything you want, and you're gonna put it about halfway down so that when we roll, we have something to tug against. So if you can find something in your house, you know, that's got some weight to it. It's nice if you have another person to hold on to it, but that's not always the case. So then I take my roller. Now roller is a whole other thing that goes on. And I don't see Ann here today. Ann Ellen, yeah, she came to get a copper roller from me because if you use copper, it brings out more greens. It's very reactive with vinegar and the elements in the water, and it will do some color changes that are really interesting. So this time I'm using almost a new rod. If I use my older rods that are really, by this point, I've used them so many times, they're dark brown with tannin, they will very much affect the print. So then what I'm gonna do is get to the middle here. Am I in the show? Yeah. And pulling against it and pulling outward horizontally, I'm going to roll. Now there's one trick that you may or may not be able to do right now is I'm angling this, and I'll show you in a second, the tiniest bit. So I get extra folds right here, and I'll show you why. You can just watch this for a minute if you want. I'm also going to smash roll it. I'll get a few turns and smash it down in there. The idea is to get really, really good contact with the fabric. And you can kind of stretch out any wrinkles that are there. So what I'm doing right here, why that thing keeps showing up. Can you see I've got some little, I'm making it so it's out of alignment a little bit. So I've got some folds at the end. Mm-hmm. When you wrap your rope around it, you'll get a nice pattern that looks just like this pattern in here. It's like a little weave. That's where the rope's going to go. And it's really hard to understand until you unroll it. That's where the string will go and put pressure, and that's kind of like a tie-dye right there. If you want to just roll it straight and worry about that little technique later, that's fine. So is everybody doing well with this so far?
And I'm here.
Huh?
We're here, so we're doing something.
Something. And then I'll pull this. Try and remember to take care of your back. So get in a comfortable position. Pull your work closer to you instead of making yourself go over to it. So now I'm going to be rolling up the whole piece, and I'll keep smash rolling as I go. If you end up having some pots that are too small, you can also just get a shorter dowel, just cut a shorter dowel so it fits in your pot well. All right, so I've got my roll now. I can kind of work and stretch out the last wrinkles. All right, at this point, you've got your piece of twine. I reuse these a lot too. And I'm going to start at the non-layered end. And all I'm going to do, and you can do this in any way you want to, and you can do it with any kind of string, you can do a t-shirt material. It all gives a different print. So I'm actually going to tie a knot right here to start with. And then I'm going to wrap around the roll in the way that it was rolled, the same direction. And I'm going to go all the way to one end. And this thing, other piece always gets in the way. And I'm going to go a little bit at an angle just for interest. And I'm going to get to this end where I have my layers.
When you say the layers, I'm not quite sure what you're talking about.
The edges that I didn't roll perfectly even, I actually intentionally made it offline a little bit by angling. But don't worry about that. It's a little complicated to do on Zoom. It's easier to see in real life. And I'll go all the way to the end. And
so is your twine about half inch spaces between it or the rolls or not as much?
Like 1/4 inch, yeah. And again, okay, you just want to get enough pressure on the leaves inside to make it work. And then I'm coming back, crossing it, and I'm going to keep pulling pretty tight. I'm sorry for my singing dog. And I'm coming back to where I started, and I'm going to go all the way past and then keep my little piece free, then come back around. And now I have the other end that I started with the tie with. And that doesn't really have much to do with anything. It's just a really good way that I figured out over time it's nice if you end up where your first tie was and you don't worry about it. Trying to find a way to tie a knot. So basically you're starting toward the fat or the one end and you're winding all the way up and winding all the way down and crisscrossing.
Okay.
We got, it's not real, doesn't have to be real elegant. And at the end of yours, you'll get, besides the piece in the middle, you'll get these lines at the end. That will happen anyway. All right, so now, while you guys finish up, my dog, hey, Beck, while you guys finish up, what you're going to do is you're going to put this in your pot with half water, half vinegar. You're going to raise it up so this is not sitting in the water, however that can be. Some people just use jars. I mean, there's all kinds of things. I've used our lemon juicer before, stuff to just keep it out of the water. And if you want, pour some of your onion skins in. That'll bring in some steam color, and you can pour some of your rust water into the stuff that's got the stuff. You just need enough to dip leaves in for the next time. And I gave you plenty, so you could use half that jar in there. So you put that in there.
Can you reuse the leaves? Huh? Can you reuse the leaves?
Can't. The only thing I do is keep the eucalyptus stems in particular and put it in my primordial soup.
Got it.
They will have spent everything they've had.
Barbara? Yeah. I've gone down and back up, but I don't know how do you tie that last.
So that's a problem. If you can meet, that's what I was trying to say. It's so hard to do this on Zoom. If you can meet where you first started, I left a little piece.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Just do whatever knot you can make work. It really doesn't matter.
Okay. I incorporated that other one into the other.
Yeah, it gets wrapped in as you wrap around. Yeah.
Okay. So
I know exactly what happened on that one. All right. So now we're going to simmer this for 2.5 hours with the lid on. You do want to check about 30 minutes so you don't dry out. You need to top it off, make sure there's plenty of water in there. And same, half water. Yeah.
How much do you start with? Like a cup?
It all depends on, like, if this was the bottom of my pot right here, this doesn't sit up very high. We've got, so I don't like that. So I take a glass jar. Let's see if I can. I take a glass jar and put this on top. So I have, now I have a lot of space to put liquid. You just want to fill the liquid up to the right before where it touches my right.
And so you want half the vinegar and half water, or one or more than one of the other?
Half and half, and then throw in onion skins.
Okay.
And then throw in a little bit of, maybe half of your tub of rust water.
Okay.
And then close it up, and then just check. It's okay to open it. There is one thing I would say, that start, don't put your roll in until the water's already boiling, because you really, it messes up your timing. Sometimes you don't know how long it takes to boil. So wait till it's steaming and ready to go, and then stick that in there and just leave for 2.5 hours. Check the level. When you're done, most eco printers say you should let them sit and cool. And sometimes I have the self-discipline to do that, and I wait and unwrap them the next morning. Some people swear that makes them better. I don't. That's too bright. I don't. Sorry, it's got so dark. Okay, there. I'll just be bright. I don't. I haven't found that much difference, and I never can wait. So.
Yeah. I like your attitude.
And you do need to cut your knot and be really careful when you cut this, so you don't cut your piece. And unroll it, and then next time we will look at them and see what happened. It's really fun.
Barbara?
Yeah.
Sorry, we were still rolling ours when you were talking about what to do with the pot. Could you say that one more time, please?
About what?
About what to put inside of the pot that steams. Yeah.
Bottom line is always at least half vinegar, half water. Vinegar is your main reactive. You will still get some more, definitely. Some people say no, but I've definitely had the experience. If you put onion skins, if you put maybe a few more eucalyptus leaves, if you put half of your rust water in, it will vaporize, and it actually gets attracted to the leaves that are inside.
Okay, so half the rust water, maybe a few eucalyptus leaves, half vinegar, half water.
Yeah.
And what's the difference between using the 9% versus the 5% or whatever vinegar?
It's just stronger and will react a little more and bring out some more colors.
Bring out more color. Okay.
And when you get later on down the line, there's some things like if you want more greens to come out, you can cook them longer. If you want more brown to come out, I mean, there's some different things you can do to ask the plants to do that. They still don't always do that.
I ran out of vinegar, and if you run out, I had 3 cups of water put in there, and I only had 2 cups of vinegar. Is that going to be okay?
Yeah. So the liquid doesn't touch your scarf.
This one, what?
The liquid in the pot is not touching the scarf.
No.
Okay.
Not in this one. Okay. If it does happen. I've had it happen before. It just will print differently right where that spot is. So it's not a bad thing.
Okay. So it's up on a rack.
Up on the rack above the water. Yeah.
Above the water.
Yeah.
I missed that iteration.
Yeah. Above the water.
Maybe I should look at your pot again.
Oh, yeah. So if this, I don't know if that helped this demonstration, but so you can see it. If this was my pot coming up here.
Right.
This is the bottom of the pot.
Uh-huh.
I don't have enough space here. I could make this work, but I'd have to refill it every 20 minutes. So I take a glass jar and I do this right here. And then this is just sitting, touching this, and on the side of my water is only up to about an inch below.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. And when you boil them later, I mean, if you get into that, you just put the whole thing in there. But it that much really smells up the house. So it's a good thing to do when no one else is around. If people are sensitive smellers, my kids would come in here and gag. My husband has no idea. He just doesn't smell any of it. So, all right. And one more thing I want to say about next week is when we're doing the paper, we're going to be putting these together in a little pile, big pile, little pile. You'll need to find, this was hardboard that goes on the back of a watercolor pad, something like that for either side. And you can only use this once. And then we're gonna wrap it really tightly. The most successful things I've done, I folded some of them and I have some cement, I mean, some slate tiles that I put on either side. So you basically need some hard stuff on either side to make your sandwich with.
Okay.
The paper I gave you, you can fold it if you have something too small pieces, like the tiles I had, I folded it because that's what fit the tiles. These pieces I could use the cardboard because that's what fit the cardboard. So it either way works fine. So just make sure, I didn't put that on the list. Make sure that you figure something that you can use on either side.
Barbara, would this strainer work, putting it in my pot upside down?
Let me get back to the gallery view in just a second. Where are you?
First one.
Oh.
Wave your hand.
Carolyn Williams.
Carolyn, there, you're down here, yes. Yes, although that's probably chromed. And chromed, the vinegar will eventually eat the chrome.
But for one time, would it be okay?
It'd be fine, yeah.
Okay, because I don't
have- Only 2.5 hours, right?
It's 2.5 hours, yeah, and yeah, I would. Maybe you can even sit that above the waterline on a jar, I don't know.
You think it'll hurt my turkey roaster? I think it's, I can put it on two burners and I think it's aluminum.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, turkey roasters are great. Yeah,
well, so my daughter-in-law cooks the turkey in it from now on, so.
I have a metals degree, so this is one thing I know. Most people, most things are now chromed instead of solid stainless steel. And chrome will eventually be eaten away, but I would try it and see, it's, you know, as long as it's not like a $50 item.
So do you have a lid on it when you're steaming it?
Yes.
Yes, have a lid on it.
And
yes.
It, you know, you'll be able to turn it down pretty low once it's all sealed up. You can kind of peek and make sure there's steam coming out. And it'll be just a very slow boil. You don't want to boil hard and fast. Things get too hot, they change colors. Huh?
So the vinegar that we use to soak our scarves can be used in there.
Yes. Yes, exactly. Water,
and then a little bit of the rusty water.
Yes. In fact, I will use the vinegar that I soaked my scarf in. And
yeah.
Pour it on. Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
All right.
All right.
It's very exciting.
See when everybody's done, and then we'll do some paper. Paper's not quite as exciting. Anything that's a cellulose base is not quite as colorful, but the silk is really, it's really fun. So.
And where do you get your silk scarves?
Dharma Trading.
Spell that?
Company, yeah, and they have that's the best price you'll find, and they're really great people. And after all the years, that's pretty much who I use. Yeah,
spell that, please.
Ehrma.
Ehrma.
Trading company.
Okay.
And if you guys, we should
starts with a D.
Right. Let me tell you my email in case you have any questions. So, it's Battwella, which is Battwella. It's Barbara Attwell, Battwella at gmail.com.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. And if you didn't get that down in time, you can always call Gloria.
Barbara, did you get the silk camisole at Dharma Trading also?
The silk, the scarf you're making today?
The cami that you showed up?
The shell.
They're expensive. I don't make those to sell because I think they're $30 a piece.
Oh.
I was terrified to print it because sometimes you really can't control it. Somebody gave me a silk robe for Christmas 2 years ago to print, and it was a $100 robe. It's the cheapest you can find. And I was like, I didn't print that thing for 6 months. I was terrified. And still kind of came out okay, not great. You can't overprint. That's another thing. If it doesn't work really well the first time, you can go ahead and print again on it. So,
Roxana, tell us what's propped up on your chairs. Are those books? Wonder if she can hear me.
Oh, I can hear you. I'm actually at the library. I just wanted to see the program.
Oh, how wonderful. It's cool. You learned a lot, didn't you, I bet?
I did. We are recording this program, so at the end, it'll upload to our cloud server and it'll be on our YouTube page tomorrow.
Oh, perfect. Just in case, I need a refresher by tomorrow.
Yeah, then you can watch it and go through the process again.
I gave you a lot of information. That's why I feel free to text me. I can answer your question in 2 seconds. So.
And I liked your handout in the bag. That was very helpful.
Okay.
Not that I've done it all right, but it was helpful.
Good.
It says steam 1.5 hours, but it's really 2.
2.5.
The handout says 1, so it should alter that.
Oh, no, it says 2.5.
2.5.
Mine says 1.
Well, I think you're unique. You're special. You have a special one.
For 2.5 hours, whatever I wrote.
Okay, yeah.
And you sound like you might be British. Of course, one time I said that and the person was Australian and they really resented it.
Yeah, that's true.
Hey, I think it says 1.5 for the eco printing on the other side with the paper.
That's right. That's why I'm looking at the wrong side. Sorry.
Yeah.
Okay. So Barbara, because I don't have the right pan, can I go back and you're saying it should be either an aluminum or a stainless steel pan. And if I use that, I can't use the pan again.
Stainless steel, you can.
You cannot.
You can,
but not the aluminum.
Yeah, stainless steel doesn't react. It doesn't add anything to the print and it doesn't hurt the stainless steel. Aluminum definitely causes more reactivity.
Okay.
And you can come borrow one of my pots. I have lots of them. So if anybody needs a pot, I've got them. All sizes, yeah.
Okay.
So it wouldn't hurt it if your scarf dries on the dowel tonight. It's not going to be a big deal. Just soak it wet. If your rolled up twined scarf on the dowel dries tonight because you can't find a pot, is that okay?
No, it'll be fine. Yes. In fact, I would probably just wrap it in some, put it in a plastic bag or something so it doesn't dry out. But even if it does, just put water on or vinegar on and it's fine. It doesn't hurt it for some reason. It doesn't hurt the silk at all.
Did you, when it says iron it immediately after taking it out of the washer?
Oh, good. I forgot to say that. Yeah. So after you undo it, wash it in some gentle detergent. I have goat's milk soap, but just something gentle. If you don't have anything, just use a little bit of your normal detergent and wash it. And then as soon as you pull it out, iron it. It's really weird. It's hard to iron after it's dried. And then even with a steam iron. So do it while it's wet with a steam iron, which doesn't, it sounds illogical, but that's what I have found to work best.
And that would be tomorrow.
Mostly I work on the silk charmeuse, which is the shinier stuff. So I haven't worked on this enough to remember exactly how to always iron it. So just realize, do it wet first. And then, you know, you guys are all ironed your whole lives. So
so you don't just hang it to dry, let it air dry. And that wouldn't take it.
It sets in the wrinkles sometimes.
Oh, yeah.
That's on the silk charmeuse. These might be a little bit, these are a little more open weave, so they may not be quite as much of an issue, but I do know it works really well to do it right after you take it out.
Okay, thanks.
And I just do like a quick wash, not a big wash. If it still smells really strong, you might want to wash it longer. Yeah.
And that would be tomorrow that we wash them and iron them.
Yeah, after you unwrap it. Yep. If you can wait till, if you cook it tonight, great, and wait till tomorrow, that's even better, but.
Okay.
Want to cook it tomorrow and unroll it right after, that's fine too.
When you wash it, do you wash it with like salt or vinegar to set it, or since it has vinegar in it, it doesn't need more setting?
When you wash it,
well, like when you get clothes, they'll say wash in vinegar or in salt so that the color sets. But
yeah, you don't need this. These will never fade. It's amazing. I have never in 5 years had one fade.
Right.
You know, I think probably if you left it in sunlight, that would be the UV damage would be the one thing that would do it. But nothing else, washing it, nothing changes it. It's kind of impressive. It shows you
Barbara,
how.
Can you do more than one scarf in a pot?
You can do as many as you want. As many as that. But they need a little room to make sure they get steam around them. But I've done 4 at a time, yeah. And you might want to cook them a little bit longer if there's more in there, just like you would if you put 4 pies in the oven, just give it another 10, 15 minutes. And if you go over on boiling, don't worry about it. Sometimes I forget and they go 3 hours or even 3.5, and some people say eucalyptus prints better that way. I just know at 2.5 most everything's good. So again, like everything else in the process, is a little bit random. All right, well, we'll see you guys next Wednesday.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Can't wait to see the products.
We can.